Hi, and welcome to Faith, Art, and Tiny Houses. I'm your host, Carmen Shank. Welcome back to the podcast today. I have a question for you. Is it possible to crisis-proof your life? Is it possible? I have about a dozen different answers to that question. One of them is probably not 100%. It's unlikely that we can do something that will make us completely impervious to all kinds of crisis across the board. So I think 100% crisis-proofing our lives is probably not realistic. I do think that there are some big steps that we can take, however. And just to give you a small, little, tiny example that is surprising me how current it is, we haven't bought toilet paper through this crisis. So today is April the 7th, Tiny House Tuesday, and we are kind of in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. And we have seen people buy up vast quantities of toilet paper. And I haven't been paying close attention to the Facebook groups where they've been talking about this as much lately. So I'm not really sure if that's ongoing. I believe in some areas that that is still an issue ongoing, that it's difficult to find toilet paper. But when we went tiny originally in 2014, I found it difficult to find a place to store toilet paper. So I became determined to find an alternative. Now, this is not for everybody, but I discovered Family Cloth. Family Cloth is like a cloth diaper, but it's cloth used in the place of toilet paper. It is not disposable. It is rewashable like a cloth diaper. So many families use Family Cloth for liquids and solids. In my case, I prefer to use it just for liquids. Liquids are sterile, solids are not. And so we have a house on a foundation with the regular sewer system. So we're actually using, I'm actually using Family Cloth instead of toilet paper for liquids, and I still use toilet paper for solids. That might have just been a little bit more than you wanted to know, but here's the thing. When everybody was going crazy to go buy toilet paper by the stacks, these huge giant packs, I wasn't in that crowd, and I haven't bought toilet paper during this whole pandemic, and I don't intend to because we don't need it. And that's given me a sense of, surprisingly, you wouldn't think, but that's given me a sense of security that, okay, so the world's about to end and we're not going to have toilet paper. At my house, that's not really a problem. What was interesting about that for me is that it never occurred to me that toilet paper could ever be the thing it has become, you know, the symbol of the crisis, and that it would be difficult to find something that simple. I've been using handkerchiefs and washcloths and Family Cloth for quite a few years now. We are not buying napkins, we are not buying tissues, we are not buying as much toilet paper. We still buy toilet paper, but not nearly as much. And those things are good for the earth, but it's also really kind of fun when everybody's freaking out that they can't get these paper products and we're fine. That's kind of nice, you know? And so that is one approach to crisis-proofing your life that I would recommend, and that is just simply making some cloth swaps. You know, for your paper products, swap out the paper products and bring in some cloth. This is really as simple as cutting up an old t-shirt or cutting up an old towel. In my case, I purchased bamboo fleece, which is really some amazing, soft, glorious cloth. It's $20 for a yard, which is 60 inches wide, 36 inches long. Available at dharmatradingcompany.com. And some of those resources are out there. Don't use polyester for this because we don't want microplastics in the water system. So don't go looking for a polyester fleece at Joann's. That's not the best choice because of the microplastic issue. Okay, so what else can we do to crisis-proof our lives? One of the biggest things is that we went tiny. We lived in a tiny house starting in the fall of 2014. We lived that way for 3.5 years. And as it unfolded, it was a way of making it so we needed a lot less to make it each month. It was a proactive step. We had some uncertainty in our financial life at that time. We had closed a business. We were running another one. And so there was some uncertainty in that time. And so moving into a tiny house, removing a mortgage or a rent payment, and reducing our utilities by a crazy amount, those were things that ended up being very proactive. And it made it possible for us to weather some storms. We didn't know when we went tiny, some of the things that we would be facing. But I'm so glad we did, because it made it possible, again, for us to weather some storms that we didn't see coming, but we were nevertheless so glad to be able to be that nimble and to need so little that we weren't completely bankrupted or devastated by some things that were to happen after that. And so I think it's really helpful to take a time like this and look around at what you've gained from living more closely with your family, what you've gained from being home a little bit more. Do you love cooking or do you hate it? Are you ready for all the restaurants to open back up so that you can go out to eat? Get out of the house. I mean, let's face it, going out to eat is half being someplace besides home and half having somebody else cook for you. It's kind of the whole experience, right? So we have really had to recalibrate when that resource wasn't available to us in the same way, because going out is a completely different thing during a pandemic. It feels different, it looks different, and it costs different. It's just a very different thing. So there are a couple of things that I have created over the last 6 months to a year that I believe will help people crisis-proof. And not just crisis-proof, but refocus in on what really matters. Because, you know, we've been thinking that having the big job and having the big house is really important. And like a friend of mine said, I have two rooms in my house and the only one that goes in them is the cats. And she's like, why am I paying mortgage for two rooms in my house that belongs to the cats? I mean, I think there's a more cost-efficient way. Nevertheless, she thought she needed those, and of course the cats are very happy with those. But I got another friend with two cats in a tiny house, so I know that what cats need is maybe a little different than what we think they need. So this is a really ideal time to take some of the downtime that we've gotten from this situation and use it for introspection. So here are three really great resources. Now, I've taken the time over the last 6 months to a year to create a class called Practically Tiny. Now, this is for people who want a little bit of help figuring out how to do really simple things, how to simplify and refine your habits. One of the ways is to go get a capsule wardrobe. Now, you can go down the rabbit hole for months on YouTube and online and read Pinterest for days on this one. And it's actually, I've done that. So I found it absolutely fascinating. There's 1,000 different approaches to a capsule wardrobe, but what I've done is taking it all and making it so much simpler, because when I was looking for what is a capsule wardrobe, the answer was not short and simple. The answer was, well, it's this and this and this. And honestly, people wearing capsule wardrobes they're turning out in like 20 shades of mud. Like, this does not work for me. I wear color. I like my stuff to have kind of an artsy bent, you know. I can't do another striped t-shirt. I'm sorry. It's just not going to work for me. I have 2 striped t-shirts in my capsule wardrobe, by the way. And so what I learned in that process of aggregating a wardrobe for myself, a capsule wardrobe, I also put into the class. And then I took the same approach, that capsule approach, and talked about the kitchen. Now, I'm a retired pastry chef and restaurant owner, so I kind of understand how to cook using all the equipment, all the gear you could possibly want, plus the staff. I understand. But now on the complete other end of that spectrum is how to cook simply with just the basic tools. Honestly, you need 3 good knives and a cutting board and a Dutch oven, and you can cook almost anything. Now there's, you know, if you love the British baking shows, as I do, and you have all of that gear, then this is maybe kind of seem extreme. But it's entirely possible to pick apart the functions of the things in a kitchen and simplify your response to those functions. Instead of a food processor, three good knives. There's not much that you can't do with three good knives if you have good knife skills. So that's where a capsule approach to the kitchen actually is really quite interesting, because we don't need everything we've been led to believe we need. I know it's hard to believe, right? And then the other thing, and especially for women, you know, we like our products, we like our personal care products, the makeup, the, you know, skincare, the all the self-care stuff, the box of nail polish, all of it. How do we simplify all of that? And actually, my most popular video on my YouTube channel is how to cut your hair. How to cut a super simple minimalist hairstyle that literally takes no styling products or styling, like no heat, no need for a hairdryer, no need for a curling iron, no flat iron, none of it. It's so super simple, and that's the most watched video on my channel. So check that out if you want to cut your hair in the middle of a pandemic. I can help you with that. But to bring it back here, there in the Practically Tiny class, there is the capsule wardrobe, capsule self-care, and capsule kitchen. That's three very practical approaches to revolutionizing and refining your personal collections of things in your home, because that will make it simpler and easier to downsize and to own less and to own better and to own more specifically things that are just right for you, instead of owning a lot of stuff that's not right for you. And that was my issue. When I first started embracing simplicity, I took all of the stuff from all of the bathrooms and put it together in one place, and was horrified to learn that this was something I had been crazy overspending. This was a real retail therapy kind of place for me. And so taking a step back and paying attention to what my habits were, and then refining and revolutionizing those, that has been so liberating for me. And Practically Tiny is my class that will help you do the same thing. My second class is called Make Room, and this is kind of the side effects of living tiny that I don't think we would have not realized this going in. But the beautiful thing about making space is that we were on the gerbil's wheel. We were going to work, getting the paycheck, meeting the needs, and we were stuck in that cycle. And you know, they tell you if you want to save money, that's great, spend less money at Starbucks. Well, that's lovely, but Starbucks doesn't, I don't like coffee. Starbucks never got much of my money to begin with, so that's not going to work for me. And for most people who really love that product line, it's going to be a temporary fix anyway. You're going to eventually want to go back to Starbucks if you love the product to begin with. So the going tiny is a completely different approach. Instead of trying to make your paycheck spread to a bunch of things, to a bunch of needs, going tiny will shrink the needs. And then your paycheck goes further. It's an amazing thing that happens. But more than just the financial change, and what takes place is this transformation I did not see coming. And that was that I had more time to focus on what mattered. When I started to remove some of those have-tos out of my schedule, it made space for the get-tos. All of my life I had been trying to get more time for the get-tos and shrink the and minimize the have-to stuff that I had to do. You know, as a professional artist for many years, that's all I wanted, was more time to create. But I was stuck because of the big mortgage, the big commitments, the big everything. I was stuck paying the bill for all that big stuff. Big house on the golf course, you know? You know, it was just insane what we were putting ourselves through in order to have a life that we thought we had to have. And I'm so grateful not to be in that place. I'm so grateful to live in a house that is a house of peace. It's just so much better. Even though the house is a fraction of the size, so much better. I can't even tell you. So my second class is called Make Room, and it really helps us think through what going tiny gives us and helps us to kind of recalibrate and refine the focus of our lives so that we can become more focused in on what really is meaningful to us. And that's an important It's an important way to kind of start thinking about some of those mindset issues that will come up when you make a move like going tiny. And finally, my third class is called Tiny on Purpose. Now, this is an unexpected place to have a conversation about purpose, life purpose, but that's what that class is all about. Basically, it just walks you through the very same process that I went through in 2000 to go from being absolutely kind of adrift to go to actually being, to become focused as an artist, to become to become the person that I was already, the person that I was gifted to be all this time. It took me a couple of times in my life to come back to the reality that I'm an artist. It was something that I was able to let go of. And sometimes you shouldn't let go of things. There are some things you shouldn't let go of. But I didn't know. I was just like, oh, well, art, you know, that's something you do if you have time, if you have extra time, if you have extra money. No, callings, things that are really calling and missional in our lives, are things we focus on. It's not something you do if you have time. And so that's where something like this class, Tiny on Purpose, can really help us zero in on what is our real sense of purpose and mission and how it is that we are called to serve in the world. And you know what that does? That gives this huge chunk of clarity. And when you have clarity, you know what to keep. You know how to stock your life to meet that purpose. And when you know how to stock your life to meet that purpose, you also start to know what you don't need. And then it makes it so much easier to let go of that stuff. And I think even if you're not planning on moving, you're not going to do any real estate changes, if you were to take that class and just explore, what is it that I need? Full stop. What is it that I really need to be in a place of living in a meaningful, missional way to serve the world well? Because we are never complete in our spirits when we are in an arrogant place, when we are in a place where the world needs to serve me. We are never happy and we are never complete when we live in that attitude. But when we come to the world in humility and how can I serve? How can I make a difference? How can I leave this place better than I found it? That is a recipe for meaning, and it's wonderful. It's crazy that it can feel so upside down. You know, we tend to focus on what I want. No, if we focus on what do I need in order to be who I'm called to be, it's a very different thing. And so that class is called Tiny on Purpose. Now, the funny and slightly ironic thing is that I have worked at understanding what marketers do just so that I could avoid their work. Because the better I get at avoiding marketing messages, the more comfortable I am with what I need, my sense of what I really need. Because, you know, what we think we need is based in what we're used to having. And it's a completely different thing than what we actually need. And so I've spent a lot of time kind of, you know, studying what marketers do. Well, that's great, except for when it comes to that moment when, I have some really helpful resources that I've put together for people, and I want to, I want to share them with the world. Well, that's marketing. Okay, so honestly, between you and I kind of suck at marketing. I suck at marketing because I would not manipulate you for the world. I would not do it for personal gain. I would not do it for any reason. I'm not here to manipulate you. Yeah, there's some things that I believe that have made a big difference for me, and I want you to know them. Of course, that's something I'm very passionate about, living simply, self-care. You know, these are things, an empowering spirituality. These are things I'm absolutely passionate about. But when it comes to actually exchanging money with you for what I know and what I've learned the hard way, that I find a little bit challenging. So I just want to be very honest with that. I just want to be very honest about that with you, because I'm not here to manipulate you to buy something from me. I am here to serve you. I am here because I believe that what I have been called to say is something that is really valuable, and I believe it's so on point for the crisis we find ourselves in right now. Because there are some ways that we've pulled in our lives and that we have reduced what we need in order to make us less pervious to crisis like this. We don't need to go buy toilet paper. we're not going to need to go buy toilet paper for probably a little while yet. And having that kind of freedom and confidence is pretty amazing. I know it's easy to paint this whole living tiny lifestyle as the savior of all things. You know, it's the way to survive in the deep, dark depression era and the financial disaster. No, I actually don't believe that. I believe simplicity is absolutely life-changing and empowering. But the tiny house itself doesn't actually have any power to transform your life. The economics of a tiny house can probably change your life a pretty big deal, but when it really comes to it, when it really comes down to it, it's the mindset. It's the mindset of simple living that will change your world. And guess what? You don't have to make any real estate transactions to gain that. And so that's why I think it's so important that we have these conversations and we talk about tiny houses. We talk about them more in the symbolic nature because they are freedom, not the house itself, but the life. The life is freedom. Now, none of us want to live in crisis mode forever. Absolutely not. But there are some things that we can do to gain what we really want most. And in this process, one of the things that I've discovered is that I really hate it that I still have a storage unit. And so I'm very much in process. I look around at my house and it's very lived in. It's maybe a little chaotic here and there. It's kind of neat and kind of not. My house is often neat, which cannot be confused with clean. And so I am finding in myself even more, even though we've come a long way on this, I'm finding it with myself the urge to continue this process for myself, to gain more simplicity, to gain more order, to get rid of a lot more stuff. And so Xavier and I sat down at the kitchen table one day and we just talked about some of the things we own that we don't genuinely want. And so we continue that process. I am not talking to you as an expert. I'm not talking to you as somebody who has all the answers. I can tell you some things that I have learned, but I can also just be really clear. Look, we are so in this together because, you know, we started the tiny house experience when we had a friend who owned a storage facility, you know, storage units and stuff. And so I don't know that I would have been all that interested in having a storage unit if we didn't know the guy that owned the place. Well, then, a year or so in, we lost him to cancer, and the people who took over at the storage unit were not nice at all. And so suddenly, we went from not being at all concerned about renting a storage unit, to having a little bit of motivation to get out of there, because they were, the people who took over were not nice. And we still have one unit. And I'll tell you, now more than ever, that's really on my nerves. That is so on my nerves now. So that is something that we're going to continue to work at. And hopefully, I don't know if this is going to be possible or not, because Xavier's list is pretty full right now. But hopefully, we will be able to get some of that stuff moved here to the property somehow. And thankfully, it's not as full as it had been there for a while. So we got a bunch of stuff moved out recently, and that's great. We just need more progress on that front. So again, I'm not talking to you as if I'm some great expert from some great height. We are all in this journey to find the resources and the simplicity that works for us, and to live a life that is meaningful and purposeful in our own assessment. We are all working at ways to refine and make our lives more meaningful and more zeroed in on the causes that matter to us. And it's really important that we take some time here and there, whenever possible, and just look around and say, is this working for me? And if the answer is no, then take a little time and get proactive. A bunch of tiny little changes in a row can equal big change before you know it. And so today, take one little step. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take one little step. And together, we're going to come closer to the life that we want to live. Our dream life is possible, even in the midst of crisis. Thanks so much for listening. I really appreciate it.
You can follow me on Instagram at Carmen Rose Shank. You can subscribe to my channel on YouTube, please do. And you can download us on iTunes. Theme music is composed by William Kirkpatrick, lyrics by Louise Estead, arranged and performed by classical guitarist Jonathan Crispin. Show notes available at carmenshank.com.